Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're doing the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and this particular series for the months of April, May, and June of 2013 is entitled Major Lessons from Minor Prophets. This is lesson number 5 in that series for May 4 of 2013, and it's a discussion of the last half of the book of Amos, Amos 5 through 9. It has some really pretty serious ideas in it that we want to look at in some depth. So we're going to ask you to get your Bibles. Hope they're handy. You don't have to go far away and dig out in the cellar to find them. And join us as we begin with the word of prayer. Our kind and wonderful Father, we thank you for these words from long ago. We understand that even some of those comments that are maybe a little bit scary are useful, and we think of these words, for example, some words from the book of Amos. Be with us now as we look at this book, that we may gather the information that you want us to gather and see the points which are important, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. The last few sessions we have been talking about a time period in the northern kingdom of Israel when they are on not a rapid decline in terms of economics and that sort of stuff. They were actually doing fairly well up until close to the end, but a rapid decline spiritually. If you remember, Jeroboam had introduced a new form of worship when the northern kingdom split off from the southern kingdom of Judah, and two places of worship were established, one in Bethel and one way up in the north in Dan, and these turned out to be places for fertility cult worship. Now, we're not told exactly what places they went to or how they organized their worship of Yahweh. The king didn't want them to go down to Jerusalem for fear that they would maybe make their loyalty back to Rehoboam and those who followed him in the southern kingdom and that beautiful, gorgeous Temple of Solomon there in Jerusalem. So he tried to divert their attention, and the results were disastrous. So in this lesson, we'll be looking, as we mentioned, Amos 5 to 9, if you want to get your Bible open to that. Amos was a migrant farm worker. That has special meaning, I think, from people who live in Southern California. He was also a sheep herder from the southern kingdom of Judah. He traveled north to speak to the people of the northern kingdom of Israel only a few years, probably around 30 years before that kingdom, we know historically, was taken off into Assyrian captivity. Keep that name of Assyria in mind, because we're going to be running across it a lot. If you have a chance and you wonder what the conditions were like in those days, turn back to 2 Kings 17 and read verses 5 to 23. I'm not going to back and read that whole section again because we have done it in the past, but there's hardly a sin that you can name that wasn't apparently rampant in the northern kingdom of Israel at that point in time. So if you, along with Amos, were to be sent to preach to these people, to convert them, to bring them back to God, what would you say? Well,
may I ask the question about yes. This paragraph? It says, this is a migrant farm worker and a sheep herder. Now he traveled north to speak to the people of the northern kingdom mm-hmm. of Israel. Why would a migrant farm worker and sheep herder go and talk to a group of people like he was a preacher? I mean, he's not a preacher.
No.
I don't understand.
Yes. That's a very, very good question. And it's a question for all of us. I mean, how does God, the question really is, how does God pick his prophets? You see, if you think about the situation in the kingdoms in those days, in the kingdom of Israel and the kingdom of Judah, you have a political branch, the king and people who work with him. Then you have a priesthood, or what's supposed to be a spiritual branch. Sometimes they weren't very spiritual, but that was supposed to be another. And then every once in a while, you have one of these outliers. It's completely unrelated to either one of these. Occasionally they were priests, but often they were not. They were somebody else, someone out there coming just like a bolt out of the blue, coming with a message. I mean, think about Elijah coming to King Ahab. You know, where in the world did you come from, you know? Well, Amos was a little bit like that.
In the first part of Amos, in some of the earlier chapters, yeah. Does it talk about his call where God said, I want you to go talk to these people?
A little bit, but not much. In chapter 7, we're going to make a comment about here just a little bit later. He's questioned by the, quote, priests, with italics here, of these pagan sites in Bethel. Who authorized you to come and talk to us? Who said you could come here? Go back home. And Amos actually tries to explain a little bit about, you know, I'm not a professional prophet. I'm not a priest. I'm not, you know, employed by somebody or other to do such a thing. Just God called me, and I had to go. I had to come and give you this message. Mm-hmm. And that's a very good question. I mean, why did God call Elijah? And why did he call Elisha? And why did he call Amos? And what in the world, why did he call Jonah coming up? You know?
But historically, it seems that God has gone to the non-authorities. Mm-hmm. To give his messages. And John the Baptist. Yeah. I mean, certainly he could have gone to the Pharisees or the establishment, but he chose not to.
Why do you think that is?
Well, I suspect that God chooses the people who are listening to him, who are willing to obey. And sometimes he has to stoop very low. You go back to the judges. You go to, you know, the story of Samson. He really had to reach low for a judge for Israel at that time.
Yeah, I guess the question is, would he do the same today? Do we have a structure that he would bypass to get his message through?
Well, any of you are professional prophets? Any of you paid by the church to preach? I am. I'm not.
No.
So maybe we're outliers too.
But yet, isn't the word to prophesy is to speak for the Lord?
Yes.
And so, humbly, isn't that what we're doing?
We're
attempting
our best.
To do our best job. Yes. I agree with that. That's what God has to work with.
Well, now let's stop and think about. Let's look from God's perspective for a moment. God brought Israel out of Egypt, mm-hmm. and we know the whole process. Finally got them in settled in the land of Canaan. Unfortunately, instead of clearing the place out so they had a pure or relatively pure environment, they were mixed all up with these other people who were worshiping all their pagan idols and so forth, and that caused lots of problems. But the goal was for them to be a light to the world. Sitting at the crossroads of society, of the cultural world, of the, you know, the known world of those days. And this is what Ellen White says about God's plan. Had Israel been true to God, he could have accomplished his purpose through the nation's honor and exaltation. Of course, that's what they wanted. If Israel had walked in the ways of obedience, he would have made them high above all nations, which he hath made in praise and in name and in honor. All people of the earth, said Moses, shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of thee. The nations which shall hear all these statutes shall say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. And those quotes are from Deuteronomy 26:19, 28:10, and 4:6. But because of their unfaithfulness, God's purpose could be wrought out only to continued adversity and humiliation. Desire of Ages, page 28. So how is God having to lead them? Not the way he wanted to lead them, but how is he leading them?
With
adversity
a ring in the nose.
With a ring in the nose, yeah, you know what?
Adversity and humiliation.
Yeah. And that's not a fun way to go. And nobody really wants to go that way if you have a choice. But what an incredible, yes.
If people are well off financially and their health is good and they're living not a very good life, why would they want to change? You know, because it's, remember, yeah, the old philosophy, look at Job, you must be a sinner, because look what's happening to you.
Yeah.
But Job was a right, God declared Job a righteous man. So the point being that God has to let bad things happen to us to get us to think.
He's
doing us a favor, really.
Often. Well, what an incredible contrast between God's plan and what really happened. And so we find out. Yes.
Well, to put a different light on this, I was reading recently the introduction to Nehemiah from the Message Bible. And the introductions are so good in that Bible. But it made me think that God is using people where they are. We don't have to go out and become a preacher or a teacher or some specific. We need people that are nurses and doctors and teachers and janitors, and use those people where they are to meet those other people. And that's what I took away from it.
Yeah. Well, Ellen White says repeatedly, many places, the founder of our church, that we may, wherever we're put, we're supposed to let our light shine. Now, we often think that our job is to earn a living and live in a nice house and drive a nice car, and maybe if I have a 5 minutes extra time, I'll try to say something for God. Well, that's not the way it's supposed to be. Well, Amos, having spelled out some of the problems that he was facing in the Northern Kingdom, starts out this second half of his book with a funeral song. Why would you sing a funeral song? Well, let's just read a few verses from it. This is Amos 5. Listen, people of Israel, to this funeral song which I sing over you. You know, can you imagine your pastor standing up and saying, let me sing this funeral song over my congregation? Virgin Israel has fallen, never to rise again. She lies abandoned on the ground and no one helps her. The sovereign Lord says, a city in Israel sends out 1,000 soldiers, but only 100 return. Another city sends out 100, but only 10 come back. That's a pretty poor return, isn't it? The Lord says to the people of Israel, come to me and you will live. Do not go to Beersheba to worship. Do not try to find me at Bethel. Bethel will come to nothing. Do not go to Gilgal. Her people are doomed to exile. By the way, Bethel and Gilgal were places where at one point in time there were the schools of the prophets. Go to the Lord and you will live. If you do not go, he will sweep down like fire on the people of Israel. The fire will burn up the people of Bethel and no one will be able to put it out. You are doomed, you that twist justice and cheat people out of their rights. The Lord made the stars, the Pleiades and Orion. He turns darkness into daylight, day into night. He calls for the waters of the sea and pours them out on the earth. His name is the Lord. He brings destruction on the mighty and their strongholds. You people hate anyone who challenges injustice and speaks the whole truth in court. Wow. You have oppressed the poor and robbed them of their grain, and so you will not live in the fine stone houses you built or drink wine from the beautiful vineyards you plant. I know how terrible your sins are and how many crimes you've committed. You persecute good people, take bribes, and prevent the poor from getting justice in the courts. And so keeping quiet in such evil times is the clever thing to do. Make it your aim to do what is right, not what is evil, so that you may live. Then the Lord God Almighty really will be with you as you claim he is. Hate what is evil, love what is right, and see that justice prevails in the courts. Perhaps the Lord will be merciful to the people of this nation who are still left alive.
Does God give us that same message today?
It's there in the book of Amos. I think it's still for us. Well, what do we do? How would you respond to a message like that?
Well, he's probably right.
Yeah.
But the people who are doing wrong, would they say, oh, yes, you're right, let's change?
Well, they did for Jonah.
You can look at the history. Mm-hmm. I mean, they killed the prophets.
Yeah.
They didn't like the messenger. Mm-hmm. They just got rid of them.
Somehow those prophets seem to touch people's sins where they are, right?
Very sensitive places, I suspect.
Well, people who worship pagan gods, I mean, Imagine that if you're involved in a religious service that involves drinking lots of alcohol, committing sex acts with a variety of people, you know, with no principles, no one to tell you what you can or can't do, just free to do whatever you like. What are you going to come out of that with? A hope that God's going to bless your crops? And that's what they thought.
Why did they go there? What in them took them there? What were they trying to accomplish? What was the rationale?
Why do people go to bars? Why do people go to, entertainment programs?
Even today, people will think of an excuse to have fun. Mm-hmm. And then if they define it as religion or define it as this is our worship, then they don't have to feel guilty about it. Don't you think that's going on?
I think so. I think there's a huge movement to try and be part of our Protestant friends and win them by being part of them. And I suspect that some of these people were using the same logic. Well, let us go be part of them, and we can witness for God, and we can win some of them to us. But it never worked.
Don't you think we are at risk of the same sins? They look different. We go to church, one morning a week. We give our tithes and offerings, and then we walk out of church, and God's forgotten about till next week.
We've done something religious for the week, and that's it.
Yes, I have met my obligation.
Let me ask you a tough question I've been struggling with, so I'm not pretending to know the answer to this. They didn't have Jerusalem. They didn't have Solomon's temple. What do you suppose these people in the northern, they were claiming, Amos just says there, you claim to worship Yahweh, you claim to worship the true God. What do you think they were doing to worship the true God?
They had a bull calf in Bethel and up north, mm-hmm. is my understanding. And that was
were fertility cult symbols.
Well, did they not use the logic that this represented God, represented Yahweh? I mean, it was...
Would you be fooled by that?
I would like to think I'm right enough not to be, but it evidently worked for them.
Somehow the people, the children of Israel, were fooled by that same thing coming out of Egypt at the foot of Mount Sinai.
Well, I could be a little more ready to forgive the people who had just come out of a situation where that was the only kind of worship they'd ever seen. And this seemed like the right thing to do. I could forgive them a little bit more than these people who had been through David, they had been through Solomon, they had been through, they knew what was going on. At least for a while, the people were properly worshiping the temple in Jerusalem and so forth. And now all of a sudden, we're worshiping a golden bull calf?
But it's the same issue we have today, I think. It's I want to do what I want to do. And as long as I want to do it, I'm going to do it.
And then we define it as the right thing to do.
Yes.
We define what we want to do as the thing we ought to do.
Well, there's two, not politically correct, words change. Gay used to be happy. Rainbow used to be God's sign. Mm-hmm. And they're getting redefined today. So people redefine.
Yeah. Well, Amos goes on. He doesn't stop there. Look at starting from chapter 5, verse 21. And I'm reading from the Good News Translation from the American Bible Society. The Lord says, I hate your religious festivals. Does that sound like God's happy with what they're doing? I cannot stand them. When you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. I will not accept the animals you have fattened to bring me as offerings. Stop your noisy songs. I do not want to listen to your harps. Instead, let justice flow like a stream and righteousness like a river that never goes dry. How do you suppose that was received?
Are you sure that he might not say the same thing to us today?
Well, we're staid and we come with our nice suits on and we sit quietly in church. Do any of you sing noisy songs in church?
I think he'd take verse 23 again. Take away from me the noise of your songs and the melody of your harps, and I will not listen. I'm sick and tired of your drum playing, so on and so forth.
Well, I see another thing. I see in the former passages, in this passage, you seem to say the word truth a lot and justice. Uh-huh. Truth in court, justice in court,
yes.
Truth, justice,
yes.
Truth, justice.
What does that have to do with worship?
In here it says, God rejects worship when you do it with a corrupt heart. And a corrupt heart does not have truth and justice. So this seems to be very important to God, truth and justice.
So you mean if I'm bribing the judge on Monday, that affects the way I worship God on Saturday?
Maybe God vomits you out of his mouth on Saturday then.
You mean like
know.
A true Laodicean?
Yeah.
Well, maybe is it possible that they had learned some new ways to worship from the pagan centers? So now they're bringing these new ways to worship into Yahweh's worship.
Maybe if we worship God correctly on the weekend, we won't be bribing someone in the court and so on, bribing a witness. Maybe
so
it goes that way.
You think our attitude toward God might affect our attitude toward other people?
It goes both ways.
I see.
A classic example is Baal Peor, is it not? As they were getting ready to go into the Promised Land. They'd spent 40 years with Moses in the wilderness, and Balaam just, look how easy he...
caused problems.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting to note that 120 years later, as the southern kingdom of Judah, now we've been talking about the northern kingdom of Israel, 120 years later, as the southern kingdom of Judah was collapsing, a similar message was given to those people by Ezekiel. Look at Ezekiel 26:13. I will put an end to all your songs, and I will silence the music of your harps. I mean, that sounds a lot like what he was saying to Israel, doesn't it?
Well, you cited so many similar references mm-hmm. As to what God wants.
Yeah.
He wants, justice to run like a stream and mm-hmm. like a river. Mm-hmm. That's not the way they were living. And
no,
Well,
maybe God doesn't want us singing songs in church. Is that what we should? Should we stop singing completely?
I don't think that's what he's saying at all.
No. We know that temple music of various kinds was used by David and Solomon in their temples, and God blessed them for it. It's not that we want to throw out music.
Well, and they use symbols, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Aren't we going to hear the angels singing the second coming?
Yeah.
I mean, music, I don't think, is the issue.
Well, what did they use? They used trumpets, they used cymbals. These are ones we know for sure, trumpets and cymbals, and I'm sure they had drums. They used harps, lyres, tambourines, and flutes. Those are all mentioned. But the emphasis in this passage is not on how noisy their songs were, but rather how irrelevant all their religious practices were because their lives were filled with every kind of sin, injustice, bribery, etc., the rest of the week.
So their attitude when they came to worship was not irreverent.
Had a problem. Yeah. Well, I already read you the passage. He says, stop doing evil and start doing good and teach people how to do evil. I mean, teach people how to do good and not evil. How do we do that? Teach people to love the good and hate the evil.
I guess example would be one way.
Example, okay. Well, I mean, it's already sort of hinted at, but let me just say it in so many words. The history of our world shows repeatedly that evil almost always wins the popularity contest.
So if you're on the popular side, you better worry.
And what happens at the end? Look at Revelation 13. The whole world wanders after
the beast.
And the beast is behind, who's behind the beast? The dragon. Absolutely. I mean, the whole world is going to be wandering after the devil himself sometime, presumably in a fairly near future.
And Lord. Yet most actions that we take are vote based on votes of the majority.
You mean we shouldn't run our church based on popularity polls?
I don't know. We sure run our country that way.
I don't understand why people think sin is fun, why hangovers are fun, what is fun about going and gambling. A lot of the senior citizens, they'd wrap them, they take them in buses and take them to Laughlin and Vegas, and week after week, bingo games, taking substances to numb your senses. Mm-hmm. For some reason, our population seems to think those things are fun.
Go ahead. I thought you were.
Whereas going out gardening or hiking or whatever, I mean, there's a lot of people who think that are fun, but the majority mm-hmm. seems to like these other things, and I can't understand it.
Do I dare to ask this question? What's attractive about sin?
It's easy.
It's easy.
It's the easiest route to make yourself feel better. And well, I don't think it's just drugs or alcohol, or, you know, we can sin in our daily lives by not having the right attitude towards our neighbor.
You mean acting naturally selfish is easy?
Yeah.
Were any of us born with sinful natures? Well, so are we suggesting, just as a possibility, that sin tends to have very short-term benefits, if I can use that word, but long-term serious consequences?
I think you just alluded to the issue. It's I versus us. If our concern is what I want, what I have, what I can get, what my influence is, that all leads to sin. Mm-hmm. If our concern is about what you get, about our neighbor, is our neighbor well off? Are we making our neighbor's life more comfortable, a better place to live? If we are concerned about others instead mm-hmm. of self, and it all seems to boil down, at least in generalities, to that issue. Mm-hmm. It's me or others. Mm-hmm. And as long as I am self-centered, I am a sinner.
Do our religious services, as they're normally practiced, in our Sabbath schools, in our church services, do they make us better citizens for the rest of the week? I think that's really what Amos is trying to sort of drive at, isn't it? Remember that Jesus himself said, Matthew 5:16, in the same way your light must shine before people so that they will see the good things you do and praise who?
God.
Your Father in heaven.
Do you really think that there will be a group of pagans out there who see you do something good for them and then they praise God?
Well, that's the goal.
Yeah, but has it ever happened?
Now I have to think about that one.
Or is he talking about the Christians, the people who claim God? You do something for them. You do something that is unselfish. One of them is poor. You help, and they say, "Well, thank God that you came along."
Well, we have a number of examples. They're mostly individual examples, but one that I can point to is Lee Strobel. Mm-hmm. He's written many books, but he talks about how he came to the church. And he was very disappointed and frustrated when his wife came home and announced that she had become a Christian. Mm-hmm. And his paradigm of what a Christian was depressed him.
Shook him up.
But as time went on, he liked the changes that came over her. And that's what Paul says. Not your dresses nor how you do your hair, but let it be the pure, simple life of a devoted wife. And that one witness, look at the profound effect. He has written several books. He's pastored churches from her individual witness.
Yeah.
I guess if somebody did something good for a pagan, and let it be known one way or another that the reason I'm doing this is you need it, but my God is the one who motivates me to do this, mm-hmm. maybe he would say, well, I'm glad your God's on board.
Well, I'll tell you, I work in a clinic every day that's designed and set up and just completely oriented to taking care of poor people. Mm-hmm. And many of them have had very hard lives. I can tell you there's a lot of my clients who come to the clinic. We are the most stable thing in their entire lives. Wow. And I had one this afternoon, lady that just came. She says, I came here a couple weeks ago and walked in here, and everyone is so nice to me, and you took care of me, and you made my life better. She said, I don't want to go anywhere else. Well, you know, and I'm not pointing, you know, I try to do my part, but a lot of other people participate. But I think that's the kind of thing we're talking about.
And I don't think it's always that we realize that what we've done for that pagan.
No.
I think you're right.
No. I think exactly we should, right. First of all, we have to develop a light to let our light shine. That's a challenge. And then we need to be aware of all the people around us. Our gardeners, people who come in for to repair things around our house, the mechanics we deal with, mm-hmm. and people around us everywhere, and watching us everywhere, and how we react.
Remembering all the time that Satan is going around like a roaring lion, looking for anybody he can catch off guard, and he would destroy us. He would absolutely destroy every person who's trying to be a Christian if he could. Yeah. These words are pretty sobering from Ellen White, Acts of the Apostles, page 431. I thought I would read them. All who in that evil day, and she's talking about the days just before Jesus comes again, would fearlessly serve God according to the dictates of conscience, that's doing right because it is right, will need courage, firmness, and a knowledge of God and His Word. For those who are true to God will be persecuted, their motives will be impugned, their best efforts misinterpreted, and their names cast out as evil. Satan will work with all his deceptive power to influence the heart and becloud the understanding, to make evil appear good and good evil. The stronger and purer the faith of God's people, and the firmer their determination to obey him, the more fiercely will Satan strive to stir up against them the rage of those who, while claiming to be righteous, now these are people who claim to be God's people, claim to be doing right, trample upon the law of God. It will require the firmest trust, the most heroic purpose, to hold fast the faith once delivered to the saints. And we need to be aware that that's where we're headed. If we're doing our job, that time is going to come sooner rather than later.
That's not a paragraph that's a good example of pagans saying, praise God, because you're here.
No. No, but it's a paragraph of what you might need to be doing when you're standing up among a bunch of, hey, pagans.
Exactly.
So we are going to be misinterpreted, but we're going to have the confidence to know God and to know what we're doing is truth and justice.
Mm-hmm. In one place, she says, we must not only know the truth, but we must know that we know the truth. Yeah. Well, we don't offer animal sacrifices in our religious services today, so what would be the equivalent? We're not bringing fatted calves to burn before a golden altar.
Well, what was the purpose of those things?
To please God.
Mm. There's more to that story.
Well, the fatted calves we bring today are ourselves.
Uh-huh. Some of us can bring more than others.
We're supposed to be God's sacrifice in His temple. And
yeah. Well, is it attending church? Is that what God wants us to do? Is it paying our tithes? Is it witnessing to our neighbors? What would Amos say to us? Would he say, like he did to those people, your worship of Yahweh is dead and boring. All the excitement is happening over at the pagan temple.
Hopefully he wouldn't sing a funeral song over us.
Oh, man.
Well, Russell Burrell was chairman of the evangelism department at the seminary in Berrien Springs. I spoke a couple of months ago in Oregon, and I was privileged to hear him. And his thesis, his message is, every member discipleship. Mm-hmm. And that's not really a popular message. We would rather go sit in the pews, have our spirit warmed, maybe be entertained with good music and nice preaching. But he's suggesting that it's our job. It's not the preacher's job. The preacher's just to get us organized and get us trained. And we're supposed to be out.
Yes.
Doing the discipleship.
Let me follow up on what you're saying. This is a really serious point. How do we keep religion interesting? There are industries out there spending billions and billions of dollars to make movies and the internet and television and music and radio with every possible thing they can think of to grab people's attention and hold on to it. In that context, what can we possibly do at church that will grab and hold people's attention? I mean, we're never going to have those billions of dollars.
Do we mimic those things, or do we give something contrasting?
Well, what about that? I mean, and of course, the real challenge is, how do we attract and hold our young people? There has been, I haven't seen statistics just recently, but I know in the past it was pointed out that if we kept all of our own children in the church would be growing faster than it is with all our public evangelism. I mean, we're losing more people out than we're bringing in. I mean, there's some natural growth, but it's pretty slow sometimes.
Isn't that true for most churches?
Yeah.
But does that give us any comfort, just because it's happening in other churches?
Do we ever turn people away from church by our behavior?
Unfortunately, yes. I've heard too many stories.
Well, you know, coming, I visited a variety of churches. But I guess each person has to find what's interesting. I find there's very little Bible study going on in churches. A lot of it is social, and one verse from the Bible can be turned into an hour sermon. Mm-hmm. And to actually get into the Bible and study the Bible is very unusual. And to me, I think that would draw people to church, is to study God's Word. God's Word is very interesting once you have it explained to you and start going through it. So
even reading things like Amos?
Oh, yes, yes.
Well, from Amos 5:16 to 7:9, it's like almost one continuous condemnation of sins. How would you respond? How would we respond today if someone showed up, a migrant farm worker? Let's be very practical. A migrant farm worker from Mexico shows up at church and starts telling us about all our sins. We would say, welcome, brother. Preach on.
Get lost.
Get lost.
Get lost or you're crazy. I think I kept a little newspaper article that was in the paper. It said in the Soviet Union, if you disagree, you're thrown into the insane asylum as a crazy person. So it's either get lost or you're crazy.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wish we had time to take a little detour. There's a very interesting chapter in the book Evangelism, pages 694 to 697, entitled The Reasons for the Delay. And Ellen White says, starting in 1868, there was already long delay. And then later, 15 years later in 1883, she said, we should have been in the kingdom before this. And she said it again in 1900, and she said it again in 1903, and she said it again in 1909. And these are her words to spell that out, to explain it a little bit. It was not the will of God that the coming of Christ should be thus delayed. Who's responsible for delaying the second coming?
We are.
Don't everybody speak up at once.
Well, she hasn't said yet. I'm waiting.
God did not design that his people, Israel, should wander 40 years in the wilderness. Now, you know, we often preach as if, well, this is God's plan. He promised to lead them directly to the land of Canaan and establish them there, a holy, healthy, happy people. But those to whom it was first preached went not in because of unbelief. Their hearts were filled with murmuring, rebellion, and hatred, and he could not fulfill his covenant with them. That's page 696 of Evangelism. For 40 years did unbelief, notice these sins, unbelief, murmuring, and rebellion shut out ancient Israel from the land of Canaan. The same sins have delayed the entrance of modern Israel into the heavenly Canaan. In neither case were the promises of God at fault. It is the unbelief, the worldliness, unconsecration, and strife among the Lord's professed people that have kept us in this world of sin and sorrow so many years. Kept who? Kept us.
Us, his people.
1883.
She said unbelief for God's people.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we say we believe, so why unbelief?
Well, I visited a church in Oregon. I'll not be any more specific than that. And I could not believe the discussion in the Sabbath school class.
Mm-hmm.
They threw out the clean meats. That was Old Testament. That died at the cross. So when you go down that road, you say, well, I believe this, or I don't believe that. I mean, you are exhibiting, I believe, unbelief. That's exactly.
You have placed your own judgment above Scripture.
That's right.
You're not asking Scripture to guide you. You're telling, I pick this and that, and I'm throwing the rest away.
Okay, so belief is Scripture.
Largely. Yeah.
So ancient Israel wandered for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
I wish we had been only 40 years wandering since 1844. Of course, then none of us would be around.
Almost 170 years we've been wandering.
We must be worse than them.
Well, and I asked the question in our handout, and we follow a general handout here that you're welcome to look at. It's available on our website at Theox, that's theox.org, a nonprofit organization, theox.org. And there we have podcasts, we have audio, we have video, and these study guides are available if you want to have a look for yourself or take them to your Sabbath school class and start asking some questions. Think of some better ones. Send us your good questions. There's a verse here that's very interesting in Amos. It's Amos 8, verses 11 and 12. Let's look at that. The time is coming when I will send famine on the land. People will be hungry, but not for bread. They will be thirsty, but not for water. They will hunger and thirst for a message from the Lord. I, the sovereign Lord, have spoken. God says so. People will wander from the Dead Sea to the Mediterranean and then on from the north to the east. They will look everywhere for a message from the Lord, but they will not find it. Is there any possibility that could be talking about our day?
It doesn't seem so. It seems that people are not interested. They reject even the subtlest hint at a God, a sovereign God, who might have some purpose for our lives. I'm looking forward to that time. I hope I'll be prepared for that time when people will ask of us, mm-hmm. what does the Bible say? Yeah. What is your understanding of God?
Well, it's very interesting that almost exactly the same wording is found in Daniel 12, verse 4. And I suppose I should read it first from the King James in the familiar wording. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. How have we understood those words in the past?
Well, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Knowledge increased, technology. I mean, we put people on the moon.
Faster transportation, new inventions, and all this kind of stuff. That's not what this is talking about. This is talking about a time when people will be desperately looking for the truth about God, and they won't be able to find it. Now, look, we've got, I don't know how many different versions just at this table, and there's so many. I mean, Jim, how many English versions are available now, even of portions of the Bible? There must be close to 1,000.
Yeah, there's over 1,000. I wouldn't say they're all available.
Yeah, but well, I mean, theoretically yeah. In English. Yeah. That's just in English. And look at all the other languages. I mean, the Bible or portions of the Bible are available in more languages. Now, I understand something like 2,000 languages or something, way more than have ever been available before. So how can the end be a time when people are looking for the Word of God?
Could that be something that happens after the close of probation?
Possibly. I don't think it's going to wait that long. I think people are going to be, you know, we talk about a shaking time, we talk about a latter rain time. And what happens during those times? Some people are shaken out, a lot of people are coming in. People are going to be desperate, they're looking for something.
But doesn't it imply that they can't find it?
Well, yes.
And some, we would hope that in that frame of mind, they could find it, yeah. And could be satisfied.
Let's hope so. Yeah. Let's hope it's just after the close of probation. I have reason to believe that after the close of probation, it won't be more than a couple of weeks till Jesus comes. So it's a very, very short period of time, yes.
Well, we see a similar situation in when people have health issues. Mm-hmm. You know, we're quite content with our lifestyle, how we live, what we eat, the exercise we get, until something goes wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, that's described as a wake-up call. There's a crisis. You know, you have an MI that you survive, or some other medical issue, and then you wake up to the fact that, well, maybe I should learn something more about how I should live.
Yeah.
Well, I suspect that the same thing is going to happen, you know, relatively soon, that there is going to be a crisis, mm-hmm. that will force people to think about, well, maybe there is a God. Maybe we should at least try and learn what he has been trying to tell us.
Let me put your point in another way. Well, go ahead. You go first.
But that would put it in the context of their ability to find it. They're after it, they're anxious to get it, and then we can get it. This says they can't find it.
Look how many people there are compared to the number of people
in the world.
In the world. How many Bible readers? I mean, I can't be too, I have to be careful what I say here, but there are pastors who presumably read the Bible every day and have very shallow understanding.
Yeah.
True.
Let me put that very bluntly in another way. What percentage of Seventh-day Adventist church members, if you stopped them one day, and midst of their activities and say, could you please give me a clear Bible study on why I should pick a topic, why I should believe this or that or the other? How many of them would be able to do that?
Minority.
A very small minority. Yeah.
Or even state what your understanding of God's will for us, you know, a salvation. Just explain your faith in God. Well, you know, people stand there with their mouths open. Well, they can't explain it. We got a few ideas and cliches we bat around, but, you know, to come to any real significant understanding.
Yeah.
Well, I think the majority, if you ask even in the church, where did sin begin or who was the first sinner, they would say Adam or maybe Eve. And then you try to say, well, didn't it really begin in heaven? And once in a while, the light will come on. But they don't understand what the import of that and what's being said.
Let me take an example. A very blatant example. When I was a child, and I grew up in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we used to say, if someone became an Adventist, we would say, have they accepted the third angel's message? Okay? That was a standard say. Have they accepted the third angel's message?
After becoming an Adventist?
Yeah. I mean, that was the key. If you've accepted the Adventist truth, presumably you've accepted the third angel's message.
I see. Okay.
That was the way it was. Okay. You must have grown up with that.
Sure.
Okay. So the question is, how many Seventh-day Adventists can explain correctly, without misrepresenting God, the third angel's message? Would you like to venture a percentage?
Less than 1%.
Much less.
That's pretty scary. Are we talking about why? I mean, how many people can explain God's wrath? Hellfire is presented in the third angel's message. The length of forever, Revelation 14, 6 to 12. Do people know? Those aren't things that are beyond the reach of an ordinary person.
Well, they think they know. They have an understanding. Now, can they defend
they
it?
They have, yeah, do
can they?
They
defend it adequately is another question.
And is it a true understanding?
Right.
Could it be at the end of time, communication will be cut off, the TV evangelist stations, the internet, and the world will have to depend on the plain old person who has read the Bible that has gone to church, such as myself or something else, to explain the Bible? And they'll be running to and fro because there won't be that many people that really know how to give the Bible studies without the TV and the...
Can I use the words of Ellen White?
Sure.
She says we will be expected to stand singly and alone. What does that mean?
And where will we stand alone? I think she suggests before Congress.
Before Congress, before judges, before... probably newspapers and so forth like this, we will be riddled. I mean, we'll be just, you know, come on, rapid fire questions. Why do you believe this? Why do you believe this? What do you believe? What and why do you believe that? Are we prepared for that? Well, unfortunately, in the days of Amos, God apparently was ready to fall silent. 30 years from Amos to the end of the northern kingdom of Israel. What happened at that point in time? Was Amos's efforts there, God's efforts through Amos, just a waste? And what would lead to things being so serious that God would stop talking?
If I may opine one more time, that even if no one from northern Israel was converted or drawn to southern Israel or drawn to God, he is speaking to us. And we can look back and we can see what happened to northern Israel, to Israel. And it's for us to change our ways to respond to Amos's word.
When was the last time we had a prophet speaking to the Adventist church of our day?
She's still speaking.
I hope so. Mm-hmm. I know an awful lot of people who don't want to listen to her anymore.
Well, you know, when, towards the end of the world, we prepare, like we have a place near us, a Mormon place that sells all these provisions that you're supposed to have in your garage and stuff, and we're supposed to be ready for earthquakes. So what I get from this is we better be ready for Bible study.
Yeah.
Maybe we better gather all these study guides and have them in one spot so we're ready to go when...
Amos ends his book, because we're running out of time here, and Amos ends his book with some encouraging words. If we do God's will, this is the way he will bless us more than we can even take in. Ellen White, and if I can turn to her once more, this is Desire of Ages, page 239. Our standing before God depends not upon the amount of light we have received, but upon the use we make of what we have. Thus, even the heathen who choose the right as far as they can distinguish it are in a more favorable condition than are those who have had great light. I wonder who those people would be. Mm-hmm. And profess to serve God. I wonder who those people would be. But who disregard the light and by their daily life contradict their profession. Desire of Ages 239. How are we responding to the light we have? We live in a society that's not only evolving, but almost revolving and not revolutionizing, let's say, changes over a short period of time. I mean, societal and cultural norms are just changing right in front of our eyes. I mean, and I, without being too obvious about it, I mean, sometimes in some ways we're starting to look like Sodom and Gomorrah. Is that what we're supposed to be doing? Can you think of any societal and cultural changes that are going on around you that are for the better? Is it correct, from a Christian perspective, to be politically correct?
It's almost an oxymoron, isn't it?
Do we, as Adventists, live healthier and longer lives because we are more closely following the advice of Ellen White, which is now so broadly supported by medical research? Or are we tending to turn away from her advice? Repentance is something that we as Christians should be very familiar with. We should be doing it probably every day. Is there a time when we should corporately repent? Should all of the Adventist Church repent, for example, for some things that happened in the past, like 1888? We're not worshiping Baals, but what are we doing, folks? Are we correctly representing God? See you next week. Thank you.